Here we go then. Game one draft, just three games away, or three matches away, from winning the international. A winner in this game, or this series, takes you through to the top four. We're into the draft right now. Loda, stick around and help us out with the draft.
I've been on vacation, so I don't want to take the pressure of like making good comments.
You've been a draft.
Leshrac has been removed from the game. A bit surprising for some, perhaps, but not for me, because I'm such an expert when it comes to the game.
You know, I've only been sat here for 4 days, even though I know that Leshrac goes out first. Come on, man.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, what to say about this game?
What does that mean?
I think it's just very standard in this current, like, TI5. It's been standard that Bounty Hunter is first ban every phase. That's very curious, because before TI5, that was not really the case. But maybe it's so much about fighting now, and if you can get more out of every fight, even trading, you know, when you trade even with the opponent, you always get more gold. It's just such a huge benefit.
Yeah, I think that that tier is for sure very, very strong, and I think that since they... people don't really play him as offlane anymore compared to like this rotating support that is just putting a lot of pressure on the map. And the thing with Bounty Hunter is that even sometimes when he fails, you can always get back into the game with the track, and then it doesn't really matter. So I think that here is, he deserves a ban.
I think so. And he should probably never have been offlane in the first place, because it's so obvious, yeah, right, when you start moving.
I think so too, for sure. But most of all, I think it's this, the toss, like bounce with track, that is what does that tier, because it's like you think in the early game like, oh, we can push, they don't really have any team fight, and then suddenly Bounty is like level 6 or level 7, and then he has this normal nuke that just does whatever, 350 damage to all your heroes, and you're like, okay, that's our mech, time to back.
It's so insane, the bounce can do so much damage. You never really expected that from Bounty before as well, and he was not an AoE damage dealer, but now he truly is. So, Eon actually removed Clockwork here, which I find interesting, but he has been a very successful hero here at the main stage. He has had a lot of good games for sure.
I really like the Winter Vibe and ban from Witcher Gaming, I have to say. Like, Ehome is so, so scary.
Against Secret? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that Winter Vibe and Phoenix combo was pretty much what sealed the deal in that game. Like, having that those two ultis that both work against BKBs, it's just...
And they were behind when they took that fight. Yeah. They were like 18 to 10 or something, and then they just crushed them.
Yeah, it was really cool to see that RTK gets his Darkseer. It's going to be a good game, we can see from just that. And I didn't have a team. It was Lina and Darkseer, right?
Yeah, Lina and Darkseer.
Yeah.
And Garou first pick. They won't get the Winter Wyvern though this time around, but...
Yeah, but still it's like a bit compared to... like what I said about Secret's game is that now Ehome already have a decent combo with Darkseer. I mean, if they, for example, if he will, this Lina will hold the like quality of Chinese Lina players in this tournament, we will probably expect like some four-man try triple stun. So I really, really like the picks.
We really have, in this tournament, two different ways to play Darkseer. Like, there's the Chinese Darkseer, which is really the team fighter-oriented Darkseer, and the Secret Darkseer that we saw was more of a just push out the lanes, pressure the map, you know, find pickoffs, just, you know, out-rotate the opponent.
Yeah. So I did a lot of solo plays where RTK, I don't really see him do those kind of plays so often, but...
Last time he played Darkseer here, he was running in under the enemy tower a lot. Like, he plays aggressive and reckless.
Yeah.
And that kind of set up a lot of people to TP react, and then his team was with him. And they just got a team wipe.
That's very interesting about RTK's style of offlane. He has almost always had this kind of role. Like, if you remember back in even DK, or in Vichy as well last year, like, he plays very, very aggressive, and he has gotten a lot of criticism for that in the past.
He's like Trixie, right?
Yeah, but
better.
But in many cases, I think it's more thought through than people actually think, because every time as an offlane, if you make the opponent team use two TPs just to punish this offlaner who is already kind of supposed to not have a good time, it is worth it. Kind of.
Yeah, it's like when he goes in and plays aggressive, if it doesn't work and he just dies, people are like, he's so bad.
Yeah.
And when he actually goes in and something happens after and they end up team wiping, we actually forget that it's because he pressured.
And you often stop the rotations that usually happen with the two supports smoke to mid. If the two supports can never leave the lane because they have to deal with this offlaner, it usually hurts more than it actually benefits you that you keep on killing him.
Yeah, you don't see that he's probably winning the other lanes thanks to him.
Yeah,
it's things like that can open up a tier 1 tower push as well. If people TP to react against an aggressive, only reckless Darkseer, then maybe they cannot defend the top tower anymore. Yeah. You can just go for a timing push.
Exactly, exactly. Other than that, I can come with my Gyrocopter is a good hero, I've noticed here at TI.
Little bit.
I don't know. Do you think it's, yeah, it's one of Hal's best heroes, right?
He plays it really well. Yeah.
It's currently picked 81 times, 60% win rate.
For Hal?
At TI5. No,
for the hero in Zephyr.
He's been playing Gyro for like forever.
Yeah, exactly.
I remember even TI3.
Yeah, TI3, I think even TI4.
TI4, yeah. He's always been playing Gyro.
I was actually thinking about that if they would have some awards for these heroes, like maybe Gyro that will like be in every TI final or something like that, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, the hero has been nerfed and then you think it's not going to be good. It's a bit awesome. Like Storm, you know, that you think like, nah, it's Death Ball now, we can't use this hero. And then you're like, well, actually, he's perfect for it. And the Eon stole the Rubik.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't ban it and you just...
Kind of ironic, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Feeding a Rubik.
What now, a Rubik?
Yeah.
I'm so funny.
I liked it. I thought that was
I didn't know. But I think a Rubik is always a great pickup against Earthshaker, especially, in my opinion. That's how I feel about it.
It did a lot in the last series. Unfortunately, he didn't get Fissure all the time, but it's always, you know, that rival, like, that duel between Shaker and Rubik, you always want to use the totem after the...
Cooldown is really good as well. Barrage is quite decent, so...
Flak as well, great.
Yeah, Flak.
It also makes it hard. Normally when you pick Earthshaker, you want to have some other good combo spells with it, so you don't really just pick a Shaker and that's it for stuns. Yeah. So there's going to be something else for the Rubik to steal, and there's some good spells already.
That's the Ice Zeus.
Yeah.
Zeus offlane.
Pretty
it's been
likely.
A while since we've seen it.
Yeah, 10 games at TI5.
But Super has played some games of Zeus as well, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it still might be a mid-Zeus.
Yeah.
It doesn't really mean that it's going to be offlane.
I do want to point out, though, that of the 10 games, there's only been 2 wins on Zeus.
Yeah, I was going to say, that hero has very, very so-so win ratio. But, I mean, at the same time, I kind of understand what it looks like. Witcher Gaming, they just want to fight. They want to be able to fight Eom.
Yeah, going up against the Darkseer Lina, normally you're like, oh, they have a really good teamfight already, but they're trying to outpower that. Gyrocopter is a great carry for teamfight. Shaker, Zeus, now they have all the damage, AoE damage particularly. Mm. So 5v5 is fine, but they still need the hero to initiate the fight, I feel. Unless Shaker can.
Yeah, and I would be surprised if they don't get any more late game potential. I guess that Vici might be one of those teams that do a lot of one core. But where I see like teams like CDEC and LGD, they usually do this
duo core
where like the cores can fight, but they also have this super, super late game potential that is like, okay, if this game goes to 60 minutes, we're not going to lose if we just don't get too destroyed.
That's very typical for Eholm as well. They always have, you know, the fallback. In this game already, they have the Darkseer wall, they have Luna. So, you know, that game is looking very safe for them. No reason to panic. That's a pretty good feeling to have going into it.
Yun and Gyro are quite even, I guess, in care potential. Gyro might be a bit stronger.
I think Luna is like a weaker version of Gyro. It's like placement. You have a longer cooldown.
Yeah, you're probably correct there that they're similar, but...
In a way, it's a little bit better for pushing in general, but like the...
Luna late game is quite scary to face, though, really. Mm-hmm. Luna and Darkseer in late game.
Yeah, but that's what I mean. But it's hard to design, because Gyro has the potential of doing this insane damage with Divine, whatever. While Luna might have a bit harder time of getting close enough to her opponents.
I mean, they have more buffs, though, I think, Vici. Like, if you look at the head-on fight, how the fights are going to start. Eholm needs to like start with probably a Yuuzhan from the or a Rubik Leaf.
Naga is not bad yet.
And the Earthshaker is just much... It's much easier for the Earthshaker to just feature and they blow some out of the Zeus.
But what kind of approach would you take for this game? Like, if you were Eholm, would you fully commit to this Death Ball now? Or would you throw in a...
I think
quite farm heavy.
I think their lineup revolves around they want to just hit the tower and Earthshaker just sits behind. And if you try to come in, there's Fissure and Zeus.
Yeah.
So it's difficult for you to just run in and there's cooldown as well.
I feel like Eholm, they have the dire advantage in that game, which is not to be underrated. Like, they have insane teamfight around Roche Pit. Darkseer, Luna. I think they can take it late game because it's going to be very easy for them to secure it. Obviously, BKBs are going to be like, super important, but once they have those BKBs, then Vici's lineup is not so scary. And then they can go for the time Roche. Vici can't really take it so far.
Do you think that Vici is going to ban a Storm now, or are they going to...
I think it's a great Storm. I think they're like baiting it. Maybe they're like scaring them with the Disruptor, but I think it's a very good Storm game.
Yeah, I think I was thinking the same thing, that like Vici might be leaving the Storm because they feel that they are already...
I think
ready to deal with it, but I would be scared about I wouldn't want to play Seat White Storm.
Would have banned it.
But TA, I think that both TA and Storm actually look very, very good here, right?
Definitely. Yeah, that was what I was thinking as well. The TA pick looks pretty good here. I always look out for that, dude.
All right.
No, I think it's Storm is playable, as you guys say, even if Disruptor is good against him. But Naga Siren not being banned out this late into the game.
But that is interesting. So it's going to be a Lina mid, most likely.
Hmm. Yeah, definitely.
I mean, that would change a lot of the things. Now EHOM has total control of when to take the team fights. That's actually really strong.
Like, I feel
they
like
can, it's gonna, they can just song and go into the wall.
It's going to be almost impossible to contest Roche for Vici Gaming if they go there with 5. It's such a hard lineup to fight into.
It's not the best Roche lineup they have, though. It's like Luna is good, but with the rest Luna, of them...
Dina
is good.
The thing is, like, if they take a fight at Roche, they are going to win. There's Darkseer and the song.
I feel like you can always Roche with Luna when you have 5 heroes. Like, it's not so hard because of the physical bonus damage. And Naga can just get a medallion or something, and then just Roche is going to go down.
I just feel like the laning phase is going to be very important for EHOM, though. Like, sure, they're very strong at the Roche fight, but...
Oh, interesting.
As well. Super pug ice. Yeah.
This is a bit weird.
So it is ice.
All right, thank you very much, gentlemen, for taking us through the draft. Let's head down to the arena where OD, Pixel, and Cinderin are waiting to bring you the first game.
Hello indeed, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the final series of the day. EHOM up against Vici Gaming as we get ourselves ready to go in. And what a game it's going to be, of course. EHOM not down here from the upper bracket, and Vici Gaming haven't lost a single game so far in the main stage.
Yeah, they started down here, so they're used to it.
They did.
It's going to be a little bit of a new experience for EHOM. Man, this series is going to be crazy. I love the draft. I think there's some really cool picks in here. Of course, it's great to see a Pugna played, finally. I think this is the first Pugna pick at the main event, apart from Cloud Knight's less fortunate experience. But in the second game of the series, I do believe they had the Pugna. And this is not a support Pugna, by the way. This is a core Pugna. It's played by Super. They've thrown ice onto the Zeus, so it's an offlane Zeus. I mean, what more do you want? And Gyro got through.
Yes.
Can you believe it?
How good is Gyro? I mean, indeed, EHOM. And but I like the fact as well, of course, we saw in the draft, EHOM this time. They've got the Rubik. So we'll see, of course, what good old DDC will be able to do with that and maybe show FY a thing or two. We'll see what goes down. But yeah, as you said, it's interesting to see the Pugna. I mean, talking to a lot of kind of the teams beforehand, there were, a lot of them were saying, you're going to see a lot of Pugna this tournament. And we haven't really. I mean, why do you feel this is the game that Vici think that the core Pugna is going to do it for them?
There's a lot of really high mana cost spells in the Dire. Darkseer uses a lot of mana and fights Lina as well. We'll be scared to cast her entire array of spells. It seems like it's just a plan Vici had going in. It didn't... I'd be surprised if it was something they just came up with on the fly. They're like, okay, now Pugna's good. Because there's been plenty of this type of games. It's just... It seems like they've prepared this beforehand going in, that this could be a big pick for them. Of course, need to keep in mind Decrepify, also a very good ability, always gives you the flexibility of saving one of your allies. Of course, amplifying the Zeus. The combo that Vici have when it comes to spell damage is absolutely ridiculous, and EHOM are going to need their BKBs. That's one thing that's for sure.
Absolutely. C2Y has been able to secure himself the top rune. Super, likewise, grabbing himself this bottom rune. I mean, the question is, of course, in the mid lane, how does Pugna kind of match up against the Lina?
I think it's a pretty even lane. I guess I'll give a slight edge to Lina. She has a little bit better base damage, a little bit better range. Pugna has the superior movement speed, though, so if it comes to ganks, can perhaps escape potential rotations a little bit better. And both of them have good spells to clear waves with. They're pretty mana efficient, both of them. Nether Blast costs 85 for 100.
Oh, top lane. I mean, Ice getting brought back here by the Telekinesis, and, well, Yang and DDC gonna give him the old chase down. It is going to be okay for the time being, but this has got to be a bit of a tricky lane here for the Zeus. I mean, Zeus offlane, not something that we've seen in quite a long time.
No, it seems like they just wanted to throw EHOM off. Like, EHOM were definitely expecting a Zeus mid for Super. It's something Vici played earlier in the tournament. And this was not what they were thinking was going to happen when they saw the Zeus pick, but they've adapted to it pretty well. Ice. Yet to get his first experience point. He should be getting it relatively soon here, but he needs to be careful as DDC is really forcing him out of lane right now.
And by the same time, Ice is able to find the XP for level 2, I'm sure both DDC and the Lunar War already have it. Mid lane, CTY coming in, just trading hits with Super. We'll find the Light Strike array. Hasn't got the mana to follow it up, though. So far in the mid lane, 5-2, 5-2, so both heroes getting pretty much an even amount of farm here in this mid lane.
Yeah, as mentioned, this is probably how it's going to play out until we get the first rotations, and looks like Fenrir is going to put down a fissure here. I think CTY can get around this. Nope, he actually can't. He's going to have to run through the river. They might even try to go for this one with the crap.
They're slowing him down, moving in. Ice is actually rotated around as well to see if he can help out the team. Chasing out CTY, find the Light Strike rear onto Super, but they're going to continue to go for it. One more Zap will do it. And the rotation from the offlane Zeus, they're securing VG first blood.
What a fantastic fissure that was. CTY did not see that coming at all. Gets blocked off. And there's the superior movement speed, actually. It came into play. Super was able to catch up. As the, I believe, 25 higher, yep, and gets the Decrepify, which was changed. It's a 3.5 second duration on all levels, which in my opinion was a pretty big buff to Pugna for situations like this. And Zeus with the rotation, ice, I think, again, those were his first experience points. He's still level 1, but if you can't get it done in the top lane, you can go gank mid with your level 1 Zeus, I guess. He was needed, too. Like, that's the crazy thing.
Yeah, it's
but they predicted they could get away with that. That was incredible.
That final zap, I mean, that is the thing as well, the fact that you're running this offlane Zeus, if he doesn't find anything from the offlane, what is the backup plan for ice? How does he keep himself in the game?
The moment he gets level 2, he can technically jungle with a static field. It's going to take a while, it's going to be pretty ineffective, but it is a possibility. You generally want to be at least level 3 though. The level 2 Arc Lightning gives the extra 2 jumps and some more damage and helps out a lot more with clearing the stack camps that he would be looking for in that situation. But I do think he's going to hang around here in the top lane, if nothing else, to keep the Rubick busy. And then that, in turn, gives Pugna a way safer mid lane. And he's the hero they've given priority. I mean, they could have swapped it around, right? They could have played Zeus mid and Pugna top.
Oh, Darkseer on the bottom lane. How? Catching that one out there with the help of F-Wiser. A second kill here for Vici Gaming.
It's a multi-purpose pick here for Vici Gaming, the Disruptor. We haven't really talked about it so far. He's really good against the Darkseer in the offlane. Of course, the moment you use Surge, you can always get him glimpsed back into a really bad position with cooldown on the spell. They have very good setup for Static Storm with the Fissure, and just overall great team fight. Static Storm, Fissure, Call Down, Zeus ult. Their entire team fight combo is actually ridiculous, so.
I can already see, of course, Lanham here in the jungle, just starting to make some stacks up, ready and waiting, of course, for CTY to come in. And CTY actually getting caught out here with the Fissure as well. Super Vim again will be able to bottle up the regen rune. And he's going to continue to chase his ice with the rotation yet again. Looking for CTY, but in at the same time comes YJ. They're trying to turn around, they'll find ice there with the Dragon Slave. And now DDC and YJ, they might look to see if they can find more. Moving up the Super with the Decrep, and now the Blast. YJ, oh, the Fissure as well, he's getting low, and he will go down there. Pops the sound. Super and FY are able to finish him off. Now with the pass. Ring for a down DDC, he's trapped with Lanham, they'll fight DDC. Now they look towards Lanham, here's a double kill in fact for both CTY and FY off the back of this. Lanham and CTY do get themselves out, and it ends up just a 2-for-2. And actually slightly favors the side of Ehun, but nonetheless very, very even. I mean, one thing I guess you could say was the fact that Luna was drawn towards it, but at the same time, Vici's Jara continues to farm down the bottom.
Did you just call Kinetic Field the party ring?
Who doesn't send? It's
everyone else than you. I like it though. That sounds good. I'm going to start calling it the party ring too. You've won me over. Nice name.
DDC hanging around mid lane now with CTY just to try and help the Lina. Lina starting to break away from the Pugna now. 25-7 against the 19-3. But CS-wise, how? Having a great time down here on his Gyrocopter. 28-15. Not a lot of ROTK has been able to do to hinder his farm. We've actually got three heroes at the moment for Vici Gaming towards the mid lane. Fenrir and FY, just waiting to see if anyone overextends. See if they can find a Fissure. I mean, a Fissure into a Decrep, into a Blast, should be able to blow up CTY if he's not too careful. But he's hit 6 here. He's got the Laguna Blade, so maybe that's what Vici are hoping, that he's going to go aggressive. And here we go, with the Decrep, the Fissure, the Blast, doesn't quite latch on. And now Ehun will be able to create the distance. No, the glimpse is there, and now the ring goes down. He's trapped in the middle. They'll get the kill there. Pugna with the pickoff. And we saw the patience there from VG paying off as they find the kill onto the mid from Eho.
And you immediately see CTY pinging out the Observer Ward that the Radiant has. It's like, there is no way they set this up without having this ward right now. And he's completely right. He pinged directly on the ward. We'll see if Ehome can find a way of counterwarding that, but so far the rotations from Vici Gaming have been incredible. I mean, yeah. It's not just that they managed to find good ganks with Shaker Disruptor, who in theory aren't the best ganking duo, right? The damage between them isn't that great. Fissure can be incredible, and of course the glimpse is nice, but it's not your classic, you know, go in with two high damage stuns and just kill off a target. They've really made it work with, once again, the Zeus rotations from ICSIs have been the most surprising thing for me this game so far. He's only level 3, though, in contrast to ROTK sitting on 5.5. That's just the nature of the Darkseer being the way superior offlaner. But so far, everything is going according to game plan for Vici Gaming.
Yeah, we did see just then, of course, Femur and Super clearing up that stack, so putting that Pugna in a nice, nice place indeed. But the Arcane Boots finished as well. He'll be able to keep up that spam here in the middle lane, as looks like CTY also backed off into his own jungle to clear up some stacks of his own. Now sitting at level 7 here, and with the Laguna Blade there and waiting, just in case anyone comes too close to him. But 7 minutes in, 5-2 at the moment, Vici Gaming. Having a superior time at the moment, the farm as well, in terms of the individual net worth, just slightly favoring the cause here of VG. At the same time though, we've seen, of course, YJ on the top, having a lot of space, did make that rotation towards mid earlier. But other than that, sticking up there, Ice, he's going to find Lanham, or Lanham's going to find him, he's going to look at the TP, but the Lucid Beam's going to be there, and Ice, getting caught out of position then. A little bit too deep for the little man.
That's going to be a Helm of Iron Will for YJ, so going for the Helm of the Dominator build up with Ancient stacking, most likely. Curious to see which direction he goes with his build here. Generally, we see Lunar players at this event get Moonglaive at this point, if not even earlier. I think previous games with Luna, I believe Arteezy went for a 4-4-1 build even, I do believe. Maxing out the glaives really early allows you to farm stacks so much faster. And of course, that's what you're aiming for with the Dominator.
Radiant's top tower.
He actually fails the stack here.
He manages to get, and the side of the die, they do get both of those there. Haste Rune going to be bottled up here by CTY. Bottom lane, we've actually got four heroes down here, Super and Femris smoked up. Trying to see if they can potentially catch out ROTK, but at the moment he is behind the tier 1, he's going to move down towards the lane now. Let's see how close he comes out, they've revealed themselves now here, so he's not going to come any closer, and it looks like VG is just going to look for the push here. With Super backing up Hal, so. We'll see what kind of reaction we get from Ehome. FY's there, ready to glimpse back anyone that dares TP in for defense. Maybe with this next wave, we'll see Vici Gaming being able to take this tower without Ehome able to do anything to stop it. We're going to see people starting to walk in. No one's going to TP directly, and CTY and RTK moving in. They're pretty low on mana at the moment, though. There's not going to be the potential for a straight-up Laguna Blade from CTY for a bit of time. It looks like Vici Gaming should be able to just take themselves this tower here. DDC is on the side. It's all being spotted out here. Oh no, so that's the dives of what. Okay, so they know that there's no one else in the trees around the side. They know that FY is not hanging around anymore. Nonetheless, with this next creep wave, Vici Gaming should be able to take this, and they're kind of just wasting Ehome's time here as they're coming down to this bottom lane, but it doesn't look like they're going to be able to achieve anything.
Yeah, it's a double victory here for Vici Gaming, not only getting the tower, but for Ehome to just stand there with their mid laner CTY not being able to engage at all. Effectively, as you said, just kind of wasting about a good minute there, almost just setting up for a fight that wasn't going to happen. We're going to see a little bit of a rotation, of course. Vici Gaming, they're exceptionally good when they have their Pugna taking towers early. They've played this strategy so many times. I personally think they play the best Pugna in the world on Super, at least in the core role. He is really, really good at realizing the hero's strengths, the timing windows, when to go, what to do. So far, it's been great from him. He's 1-1-3, he's taken the tier 1, still has 50 CS, minute 10 in that mid lane. Very solid Pugna performance out of him this game.
Mass rotations here coming out from the side of Ehome. Smoked up how to reveal himself on the top lane, but now he's keeping it safe, hiding in the tree line. Double damage rune is there, waiting and available if they wish to take it. CTY will grab it. It doesn't look like they're going to find anything here with this smoke, as Vici Gaming pretty much safely tucked away on their side of the map. And CTY is just going to go back and clear up these stacks. Try and chase up the Pugna in terms of net worth. He's quite a bit behind, but of course, down to the fact that Vici Gaming did find that very, very early tier 1, so this stack should help close the gap here for CTY.
Now, how close is he to Yules? It's pretty far away. He's died twice. Does he have anything on the courier at all? No. So he's still a good, what's that, 1500 gold away in minute 11. And he is a very explosive player who is very, very good at taking advantage of an early lead, but that's not going to be the case for him this time around. As you said, though, good catch-up for him here, at least. I think we're looking at what could be in a 13-minute Yules, perhaps? Still got a way to go.
Oh, at the same time, talking about good time. 11 minutes in, Pugna now has got the net complete on top of the arcanes and bottle, so Super looking very, very good here on this Pugner. And if they want to group up and push another tower, it's going to be even harder for Ehome to fight into. We saw Vici do it on the bottom lane, Ehome unable to do anything in response. And Vici, they're going to look for more here. Smoking up, moving towards the top lane. How at the moment, acting as a little bit of bait, being the only one revealing himself. And they're going to be there ready with the counterattack if Ehome decide to go for the Gyro. But even if that's not going to be the case here, Vici Gaming, they'll have the time and the opportunity to go for another tier 1. In fact, DDC looking to DP out here, they'll get the vision with the Thunder God's Wrath. And now with the Fisher, DDC in a lot of trouble. He's trying to run away here, but Super will close in on him. And the Nether Blast dropped down, didn't quite catch him, but Ice there with the Arc Lightning. Sal's being popped by DDC, he's trying to do what he can. It's not enough, and they'll lose the Rubick here. And the side of Ehome will almost certainly lose this tier 1 as well. YJ and Ladum, they're looking for potentially something in trade, pushing on the tier 1 in the middle lane, and ROTK amping up the pressure on the bottom, but it's not going to be on the same level as the pushing power here of VG Gaming as they force out a fortification and we'll be able to finish the tier 1 pretty soon after. FY already in the mid lane, starting to drag the creeps back. So again, they find a tier 1, they find a Rubick, and they don't lose anything in return.
Ehome in a really problematic position here where it seems like VG Gaming can just pick one tower after the other and just go for it. And Ehome need items to fight. Their heroes just flat out get countered by this whole mech and AoE control combo. Luna has to come in close for the Eclipse. She will get blown up. The Lina can play at somewhat of a range, but she still needs to get inside.
Oh, Ice trying to DP out, but Lanham coming in here with the net. Now with the illusions hitting away. Super is there. Can he help him out? Looks like the Nether Blast will be enough to scare Lanham back off. So Ice keeps his life intact. He's going to be looking for the time being bottom lane. They will find Isaac. Get the deny here. And now with the fish. Oh, the cooldown is going to hit onto two. They've blown up ROTK here on the dark side. FY should be able to find DDC as well. Down goes the kinetic field. It will trap him on the edge. Ephemeris trying to move in. Lightstrike Ray is duped out. And it looks like the rest of Ehome will be able to escape here.
DDC is just going to let him sidelines.
Oh, nothing to cancel. It can't quite stop that one from going off, but nonetheless, they get the deny into the tier 1 and they get the Darkseer as well, so more favorable events here for the side of Vici Gaming.
I'm very surprised FY let the Rubick run there. I'm not sure if he was scared that the Luna was starting to flank him, but he had Static Storm ready, he had Glimpse ready, and he had Thunderstrike on the target, and a little bit uncharacteristic for FY. Usually when he catches someone inside the kinetic field, they do end up dying one way or the other. But they let DDC get away. A little bit of a freebie there.
At the same time, of course, the Ice has had a bit of space in the mid lane. He's working towards his Midas. He's actually got the recipe already picked up here on the Zeus. So considering the time he was having up top and the fact that he wasn't finding levels at all, this is going to be a pretty respectable timing for the offlane Midas on Zeus.
Yeah, that's what all this tower gold does. And of course, getting an assist as well as a kill doesn't hurt either. And he's going to become relevant. Like, I really like this choice from Ice. I think a lot of the time, Midas is actually a really good first item on Zeus because this hero scales exceptionally well into the late game, but doesn't have the best farming pace in comparison to a lot of other cores played, particularly in the mid lane. And in this offlane role, there's not so much pressure on him to perform right now.
And they'll get another tower here. More gold into the pocket of Vici Gaming. 14 minutes in, all the tier 1s taken from the side of Ehome. I mean, we can see already the fact that Howe's sitting on 6.3k net worth here on this Gyrocopter in a very, very good position. YJ trying to take what he can here from the enemy jungle. On top of the helm, the Dominator has the Ogre Club. But at the same time, in comparison to Gyro Howe, he's nearly got the BKB completed. Only about 400, 500 gold to go before he's got that one done.
And speaking of BKB, it's got to be the story for Ehome. I think their chances of fighting under the Netherward without a BKB on the Luna and maybe even the Darkseer looks pretty grim for them. Nice. So the problem is, whenever Ehome want to engage a fight, they kind of have to use Song of the Siren to get in a good position. But the amount of counterplay that Vici has drafted, Fissure, Glimpse, Static Field, and soon the BKB on the Gyro, as well as the Nether Ward, is probably going to make them think twice about going for any fight at all. It's just a matter of time before Vici Gaming start looking at these juicy tier 2 towers. The top one should be a very easy target for them, as it's a great area for them to fight in.
I mean, what do you feel that Vici Gaming are waiting for now in terms of it? Is it an item pickup before they start to go deeper onto enemy territory and look for a tier 2, or are they waiting for Ehome to try and come onto their side of the map and look to just fight them at their own tier 1s?
Well, ideally, let's see, what are the key items? BKB on Luna, Lina has to find some sort of solution for the Nether Ward, like in her item build. She has the Yules now, but that's not really going to help. And the Darkseer is going to need, so perhaps a blink on RTK and they just land a super combo and they can try to fight into the BKB Gyro and the Nether Ward. That's going to be ridiculously hard, but it might be what they have to go for. So yeah, I'm going to say that. Blink, Darkseer, and the BKB on Luna, absolute minimum to be able to win team fights. Now, of course they can look for skirmishes. That's still not out of the question. You can try to smoke up with a Rubick and Lina. Should make for a pretty easy single pick off on most of the Radiant heroes who, of course, do have that innate weakness that they have very low health pools.
How? He's feeling pretty confident up here. Just farming away, pushing up this top lane. All on his own, because the rest of his team around towards the mid lane actually going to smoke up here. And potentially going to wrap into the dire jungle. Maybe hoping to catch E home that may be moving towards tower. It's getting drawn off on the map here. Nice Ice Ice heading up to the high ground. They don't quite have vision here of CTY. They're going to move in. It's like, yeah, okay, so FY's going to lead in here from the river. Heading towards the tier 2. Looks like E home sense that something's off. They obviously notice that VG Gaming off the map at the moment. They know that VG are potentially moving in, and yeah, they're hiding right in the trees here, E-Home.
I think you saw DDC already. Yeah, it's being pinged out here by Super. I think they probably just dive for this one.
Dropping the kinetic field here, won't catch anyone, but will trap CTY on the other side. And now DDC, oh, he's actually stolen a Nether Ward here, so this might be pretty useful in the fight. There's two Nether Wards down, one for each side here. Lannan with the ult will be able to take down VG Gaming's Nether Ward, and now the fight will continue. Super getting low pots. The mech is not going to save them. How moving in now with the BKB, trying to find RTK. RTK's got the mech, he's going to surge himself out here. And this is actually pretty good here for E-Home. They do lose the Rubick, but they find Super. And they don't lose anything else here. And well, VG Gaming might resume to start pushing on the tier 2, but pretty good pick off there for E-Home and what looked like to be a good initiation from VG Gaming.
Yeah, Luna TP'd in and got glimpsed away by FY. I'm not sure if that worked for or against VG Gaming, because it looked like Hal might have actually been able to run down the Luna, but of course, with her getting glimpsed out, he starts running for the Darkseer instead. And it ends up being just a 1-for-1. They don't get the tower. Hal uses his BKB, in my opinion, a little bit prematurely there as well. Used it very early running in. I guess he wanted to make sure he got the cooldown off during the Song of the Siren. Well, they didn't get the best fight of it out of it, as you mentioned, but also not a disaster. I think this is just that, you know, they're going to get the tier 2 now, because they could just run out again, up again with Pugna. They know Song is on cooldown. They know Wall is on cooldown. They know Eclipse is on cooldown. And if you look at their team, they don't have these key long cooldown ultimates. Zeus ulti is 90 seconds. Disruptor ult is currently also 90 seconds. Echo Slam is not being used right now. It's a long cooldown, but they don't need it. He's all about the fissure right now.
It's going to be the tier 2 going down. So VG Gaming, I've got to be honest, with kind of the game plan that you would expect from them when they had this draft, it seems to be going absolutely to plan. I think they're going to be very happy with the progression of this game.
They want to force them back again. They have BKB on the Gyro. This is a pretty aggressive play pushing the base at 19 minutes, but honestly, I think it's the perfect play call. They have all the advantages right now. Why not push it if it seems unlikely E-Home can find the type of fight they need?
Well, with the Nether Ward down as well, it's going to be hard for E-Home to fight into this one.
Well, it's a good steal from Rubick.
He's got the glimpse here. Let's see if he's able to use it to find into this. They do have the wall. Same time RTK wants to be careful with the ward. Okay, the ward's gone now, so maybe we'll see E-Home try and fight into this.
They got 2/3 of the tower for nothing.
Yeah, this is a bit worrisome here with the Nether Blast indeed for E-Home. Just slowly losing before the 20-minute mark as well. It really feels like VG Gaming's lineup is just so much stronger than E-Home's at this point, because they don't really have an answer for the playstyle that VG Gaming are going for at this point of the game.
Yeah, I think the E-Home should have got a little bit more out of that situation than they did. They lost 2/3 of their tower. There was no real trade-off. And the issue is that in that particular situation, you probably want to have the Luna split pushing, because she's not really contributing very much to the engagement. And you don't need to be scared of the TP into Glimpse anymore, because she does have the BKB. So now YJ can, whenever they're looking to go for a five-man somewhere, he has to be on another lane, so he puts them on a timer. Else VG Gaming feel like they're never losing anything, and they can just take their time. So that has to be the role YJ needs to play now. This bottom lane needs to be pressed out as much as possible at all times, and he even has a good lane ward down there to protect him from ganks as well. So should definitely be on top of his priority list to
smoke up now. VG Gaming moving in across the secret shop here. Might be able to ret round towards mid. There is a fair few of E-Home here. This could be things could kick off it. They're actually just going to look at the Ancients. Just getting to sentry down, looking to block the ancients and get themselves out without being discovered.
Actually.
And they're going to be able to do so. Blocking up the ancients here.
Yeah, I'm looking for a fight as well. Zeus is rotating over. He did port down. I think he was not spotted by the dire ward down here. He might have just crossed through some of the vision, but I don't think so.
Oh, maybe trying to move in from the side here, Vici Gaming. Huddling together here in their own jungle, Ehome backing themselves up. So again, they won't be able to find a jump onto them. And okay, with that sentry pot down, they should be able to deward that ancient block on the side of Ehome. And oh, it's actually Lina. And very deep here, the pings come out, CTY is going to go straight for the TP, but the glimpse is there, it's going to get cancelled, and CTY in a whole world of pain, nowhere for him to run. Everything getting thrown down onto the Lina, and CTY just getting a little bit too ballsy there with his TP.
Zeus Disruptor is such a powerful combination. The moment you have any idea about where any single hero is, you just Zeus ult and they can't escape at all. Very, very easy pick off here, and CTY just out of position, got a little bit too greedy there. It's going to cost them a tier 2 most likely. He really doesn't want to buy back. Look what he's building. He's doing what I thought we might see for the first time this tournament. He's going for a very early BKB on the Lina, because it's kind of a forced item pickup against Pugna. It's part of the power of the hero. I mean, sure, you buy the BKB to counter the Nether Ward, and that's great, but then you don't have something else, right? So that's definitely a big advantage for Vici Gaming here, forcing the enemy heroes into item builds they don't really want to go for. I think we're going to see something similar for the Darkseer as well. Probably ROTK will look for the Blink first and then BKB instead of something more valuable for teamfights, such as Shiva's Guard, Hex, or yeah, something along those lines for staff.
Smoke up now from the side of Ehome. Maybe they're feeling confident enough to try and take a fight themselves. BKB and just beginnings of Yasha here onto YJ on his Luna. Actually going to look for Roshan here potentially, and they might just get away with this one because Vici Gaming towards the mid lane at the moment. Going to do it fairly quickly here with the aura from YJ.
This would be a really big play from Ehome. They're taking a chance here, but I think they have to. If they just have
it's been spotted out.
If they're not making this. If they stick around here, this could be game losing. Or maybe they are, actually.
They're doing it pretty quickly. I mean, Super is moving over here to the pit, but I mean, Ehome are going to have it done. They're going to have it done.
Okay. That suddenly went a lot faster than it started out. I guess CTY started getting up the fiery souls there.
That's a nice fish and a nice cooldown here, but the Yule Scepter holding Hao back. And Hao will contemplate it, but he's not going to move in any further. Ice trying to get the Thunderbolt in, but hit with the snare onto him. Wolves being dropped down by ROTK. Vici, they've got the glimpse now. RTK gets dragged back and he's stuck here in the kinetic field. Now look at the Darkseer, they'll blow him up! And that's the gem on the deck as well. Now Hao moving in with a BKB, trying to chase down CTY, but CTY just a little bit too quick here with a fiery soul passive. So the side of Vici, they do secure themselves the gem of the buyback from RTK now. Oh, with the ultimate there for Luna. They do find Hao. BKB was popped by Luna there as well. So they do get Hao in return. I don't believe they recovered the gem. They did. Who picked up the gem here on the side? So Earthshaker has got the gem. Emra did manage to get that one out of that fight. And it did cost them a buyback Ehome, but still. I guess they got Rosh. Would you say overall that's Ehome's advantage, killing Hao? I'd say so.
Yeah, they have the Aegis and they got Hao. Yeah. I think that's good enough. Even though they buy back the Darkseer, which turned out to be completely unnecessary, maybe it put pressure on Vici, so they pulled back. But I think they had to do that anyway. So a little bit of a rushed decision, in my opinion, from RTK. But it's one of those very difficult moments where you need to realize, okay, how far ahead are we really? There's no BKB on Gyro. It was on cooldown. We have the Yules out on Lina and can kill him easily. So
he's got BKB down now as well on CTY.
Guess who's also got one? Exact same time, it's the Pugna. And of course, you look over the Ehome lineup, their physical damage right now is extremely limited. Luna needs time to come online. He hits for 200 right now, which is great, but you can't really run in close with Luna against a Pugna right now. It's pretty unlikely that he'll be able to succeed in blocking and running him down and killing him off. And the Laguna Blade, of course, if you're CTY now, you want to get that Aghanim Scepter so you can get Pugna out of the way if possible, or the Gyro. But your build has been delayed by about 4,000 gold because of that BKB.
Oh, Thunderbolt Graph just coming out at a time that Ehome may have looked to smoke up. At least Ehome know now that it's down. It's not going to come out against Super. Has hit level 11 here. And what does he go for now himself after the BKB? Does he go for Ags here on the Pugna?
There's a couple of avenues he could think about here. One of them would be a Necro Book. I think maybe it's a little bit too late for that. Luna's also really good at clearing them out with the BKB. alternatively, he could go for the Axe, like you said, and just try to, you know, he could be like a medic for the gyro, basically, so he can siege high ground. And alternatives, you know, Octarine Core is actually not that bad on this hero. The cooldown reduction is really, really good. To have Nether Blast, you have almost permanent uptime. Actually, you do have permanent uptime on the Nether Ward as well, then. And it's extra drain from your spells, which is also nice.
And the jungle.
See, Hex is good too. There's a lot of items on Pugna, just
okay,
utility.
They got the glimpse here onto CTY, trying to move Hau in as well. CTY just a little bit too speedy. I don't think Hau's fast enough to really do anything about this. Hasn't got a point on homing missile yet. CTY is going to be able to get himself out. So.
Very, very confident play from CTY, not using the.
Yeah, he's got the Song of the Siren in. He's going to use it. He's going to get himself out. Or is he going to get himself back in? The rest of the teammates wrapping around down the river. Now another breath fight here with the Laguna Blade as well. They're able to take down Disruptor before he gets anything off. Nano's got the Limit Cave. It's going to be able to keep him alive. Yes, it is. With a mech coming in from RTK. Now Nano with the Mirror's Image. Going to be able to get himself back out. It's just the Disruptor that's fallen so far. Ehome getting low. Hau trying to do what he can with Ephemera and Super. Super spot the BKB. Now YJ. His BKB has run off. And they're going to chase out Thundergod's Wrath here. Ephemera trying to move forward. Finds the Fissure onto YJ. Now with the Rocket Barrage, they'll get the Luna. Now Ephemera looking for more. Super with the Never Blaster to grab onto RTK. They'll find him. Echo Slams for that one. This is double kill for Ice Ice Ice. Can they find anything more? CTY is just getting himself out, and it looks like CTY and DDC will be the lone survivors here at this fight, as VG Gaming only losing FY here on the Disruptor and finding three kills off the side of Ehome.
Yeah, they don't have their glimpse to find extra kills here, but they found something that's really, really valuable.
Oh, lots of gold going to Hau and the boys here.
You know, they're 2,000 gold ahead. Like, it's a very marginal lead for VG Gaming. They're behind on experience, too, which is kind of surprising for me, to be honest. But
I guess it's just because they've been grouping up so much, and they've been doing this pushing, whereas Ehome, they've been a little bit more spread out. There's been a little bit more stacking going on in the jungle.
And Lina just farms faster than Pugna does. You run out of mana on Pugna until you have Bloodstone. He can't really go for it this time around because he has to get the BKB. He feels it. It's the big difference. It's again, in terms of relative strength, it seems like VG Gaming are more than 2,000 gold ahead in reality here in the team fights. Their execution is also just a bit better. And Ice Ice Ice, by the way, remember that poor offlane Zeus?
10 Bloodstone charges.
I mean, granted, it's 28 minutes in, but he had a Midas build-up too, which also cost him 2,000, so he has recovered fully, and he's going to become really scary. I think a really cool item for him this game would be the Veil of Discord. There's just so many abilities that synergize with it for their team that I think it's an incredible value pickup. Even against these BKBs, they're not going to last forever, and it's when they expire that Vici are going to look to hit hard.
Well, JS Farm continuing. He's nearly got the SMY finished now on top of the helm on the BKB. Just a couple hundred away from that final sand recipe. And over onto Hal's Gyro. Demon Edge now done. So he's certainly starting to pack a punch. He's still got a bit to go before he finishes off what I imagine be that MKB as his next item. DDC, 1600 gold on the way to his Blink Dagger. So we're going to see Rubik get that one fairly shortly. But all in all, 29 minutes in, it's been quite a slow-paced game. Only 13 for 6 at the moment. Just the big difference being the fact that VG Gaming had that momentum, but now we're at a point where they're only one tier two ahead of the push of Ehome, as Ehome, as we've seen with the illusions there from Lana, is constantly applying the pressure on the bottom lane. VG Gaming, though, they're going to group up, look for top. We saw Hau earlier they were able to do a significant amount of damage here to the tier three, and maybe now they're in a confident position to try and finish that off and maybe even look for racks at this point of the game.
Our TK is very, very poor, which is a problem for Ehome, because they would like him to have a positional item so that it's a lot easier for them to find the engage. It's pretty unrealistic to get a good...
TK blown up there! The Decrepify increasing the magic damage by too much for the Darkseer.
Rubik stole cooldown, though. That is a very good spell. They might be able to hold without the Darkseer, but this is going to take an incredible...
Glimpse on CTY, the Rocket Barrage as well. The Yawls is going to be there. Why is CTY the time to escape? And Lannan with the song, is he going to try and reinitiate with anything? It doesn't look like he's just holding his position. Hau just going to turn his attention back towards the structures here, back towards the barracks. Super with the Nether Blast as well, bringing them low. YJ trying to come forward, drops a Lucid Beam down onto Gyrocopter, but VG Gaming, they'll find the space here to find their first set of racks here from the top lane. And Ehome, nothing they can do about it. VG Gaming as well, all still sitting at full health. They may just look for more here. I guess they're still going to get the tier 2s on the other lanes, and they both have been pushed back out towards the map side of VG Gaming. So they've got a TP back and look to push those back out before they want to try and find anything more for the base of Ehome.
Ice 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 using the taunt on the way out. A little bit of a Super Mario jump there. He's kind of feeling good about himself. He had a very hard lane. He played, you know, he did, did he even die? He died in the lane once, I think, but he played it back well. It's a super difficult lane for Zeus. Did a good job, he got some good rotations off, and it's having a massive impact on the game right now. He's got to be feeling good about himself and about Vici's chances of winning this game. So they just got a massive lead now.
Yeah, well, thanks for that set of racks there on the top. XP still hovering around the 0 point. VG Gaming have been able to bring that back around. And I think the good thing as well for VG is, even though it's even, a lot of their farm is on this gyrocopter. He's now coming up to 16,000 in terms of net worth and how getting very, very scary. In fact, I think that might be the completed MKB.
It is.
Yes, it is. So MKB done on a how now, 31 minutes in with the BKB, SMY. And just with the whole team composition, it's going to be so hard for EHUM to fight into, which is pretty much the problem they've had all game when they've been trying to hold back the side of VG.
He's just one step ahead of YJ already. YJ is building towards a butterfly, and the MKB is already prepared. So when it comes out, it isn't really going to make that big of a difference, because what can you use it for? So you can try to dodge physical attacks that VG Gaming aren't really using that much. The only one hitting hard is Hal, and he doesn't care about your butter. And all the others are all about the magic damage. So you still have the same problem. When your BKB expires, you're toast. Like, this lineup can easily output 2,000 magical damage onto a single hero within the span of 2 seconds, and that's his health right now. So, scary.
Trying to get the push on this top lane, but he's going to have to TP back for the defense here, because Vici already on it. DDC with telekinesis onto Hal, trying to bring him back into this one. The good play as well, Hal getting low. Oh, he gets taken down before he can do anything in response. Fantastic play there from EHOME, and now they're going to look for more. Looking for Fenrir. The song's going to come out. They're trying to set this one up. Should be able to find the Earthshake here. He's been left behind. They're chasing down. Fisher was stolen a little bit off the mark. And Fenrir with the Glimmer Cape. Looking for the Jukes, and he's going to do it as well. Into the hiding spot. And TP's out.
My God.
Very nicely done there by Fenrir. FY tries to TP out himself, but the telekinesis there from DDC. Land him as well. And oh, they'll take him down. So they do find two heroes there, EHOME. This time, the defense is more than successful. Very nicely done there by the Dire.
Solid play from DDC. Seeing the opportunity to engage there with the Blink Telekinesis, they blow up the gyro immediately, and even if there is a counterplay for VG Gaming, they know they can just use the Song of the Siren and ensnare the target, lock him down, and try to bring him down as well. So, Hal in this situation, a little bit too aggressive for his own good. I mean, it's understandable he thinks he can go there, because he is, of course, he knows he's rich. Mm-hmm. He has big items, but they're not very good defensive items if he doesn't get the BKB off. He has no evasion. Of course, going for the MKB buildup instead of the butter. And they do punish him for it, although the majority of the damage they did was magical. And now, it's going to be a lot easier. There it is for CTY. Our TK is going to grab Guardian Greaves, so no mobility item for him.
I guess they've got the initiation of Lanham with the song. He set it up for a nice vacuum wall combination coming out from RTK. Ice size continuing to be incredibly rich. 2,300 now on top of the Blink Dagger he's found on that Bloodstone. So the farm's still looking very, very good for Zeus. Roshan is now back up, and it's just kind of a question whether VG feel confident enough to go for it. So it's going to be a little bit tricky, especially when you're doing it up against the lineup with the Naga Siren, who does have the song back online in 20 seconds. So they're going to try for it anyway. They're moving in. And they're going to go for this one. And they're going to start it off here, VG. But I'm sure EHOME are going to have something that they want to say about it. They're making their way towards the pit here. I don't know if VG want to keep themselves sticking around. Lanham's got the ult available. And I think VG realize that'd be a little bit too risky to go for Roche now.
If nothing else, they get a lot of information out of going for that play. They find out EHOME's heroes. They force a rotation. If they just wait now, the top lane.
TDC looking forward. Are they able to disperse of Hal straight away as well? Oh, the Glimmer Cape is going to buy him time. The one has dropped now the corner. Hal with the BKB. He's going to turn this round, moving in. But the Laguna Blade is too much damage. CTY is able to take down the Jarrah. Now Lanham with the Song of the Siren. They're looking for more here. Will they be able to find him? Moving in onto Fenrir. Fenrir getting low. Move on the charges. They'll lose him. It's going to be three now, but they have found two in response. YJ is still alive here. Johnny going to hit out, but Ice. He might be able to clean this one up. There's a bolt. Double kill now for Ice. EHOME, four of them hitting the deck. It's only DDC able to escape. And it ends up as a 4-for-3 trade. And Ice very nicely being able to clean up off the back of that one.
EHOME is doing such a good job at bringing down Hal with these initiations. This is a perfect type of engage they can get. They get the lift, they force out the BKB, they immediately song, and then they blow him up with the Laguna Blade, but still not able to find enough. And it's simply because Luna doesn't have enough damage items right now. They get kited a bit too long because they can't run them down and bring them down quickly. Ultimately, when the BKBs expire, Vici's lineup is just...
Oh, he's found DDC as well. Jumps in, drops a quick bolt. That's going to be a DDC does link himself away. But I've got to say, Ice's performance this game on this offlane Zeus, he's got 7 kills, 5 assists, only died the 2 times, and he's racking up the gold as well. 5,000 gold in his bank. This is great play here from Ice.
He could look for a refresher right now. I think it will be the right item. It's going to more or less blow up the Rubick with 2 ultimates. It's going to put Darkseer under a lot of pressure. And of course, you don't have to use it like alt, refresh, alt. You can use your entire array of spells, then refresh and immediately use it again. That way you get 6 static field procs, you get 2 ultimates, and of course the lightning bouncing everywhere. There we go. Good choice.
Roshan is now up. Axe is complete here on the Pugna. And Zeus, yeah, he's picked up straight up. Just buying it casually like that. Completed refresher orb.
If he doesn't die in the BKBs of Ehome, he has the potential to set his team up to win like a situation like a 2-on-5 in theory. If they're all like half health and BKBs are out, Ice can just be a one-man wrecking crew right now.
So he'll be found right. He's got 1400 on his way towards that blink dagger. And we'll see if he's able to pick that up after one more successful fight should push him over the edge. But Pugna pretty much in his element now with that Axe, and also holding the gem, of course, for the team. Forstaff is also ready and waiting. And find the Disruptor looking for the Axe. Whoa, that's a lovely party ring with a static storm. And oh, Ice with the ult. Does get Laguna Bladed down now with the luck trade. They bring down ROTK in response. YJ, CT1, how all using their BKBs. How's going to try and chase down CTY here? The Song of the Siren coming out from Lanham. And it looks like it's going to be a defensive one as Ehome TP themselves out. Simply trading ROTK for Ice there. I think they're going to be happy that they did manage to kill that Zeus there, because he's been having a great game so far. And as you can see from the golden XP difference, it certainly shows that Ehome come out on top there.
Again, DDC, phenomenal play. He sees him in the pit, he lifts him, tosses him toward the edge, then they vacuum him over the edge, and they put so much pressure on the Zeus that he has to double ult. He doesn't even have time to cast the other spells. So his impact in the fight is not what they were looking for. They still get a 1-for-1 trade, and is going to give them the Roche, but the conditions that Ehome are fighting under, that was still very, very good.
Roche is going to go the way of VGM. With this, they may feel confident enough to try and push in another lane, try and go for a second set of racks in tier 3s. As they're looking in very good position in comparison to Ehome. I mean, how's the actual overall graph looking? Okay, still about 7,500 lead here for VG. Not a massive one for 40 minutes in, but it's a lead that's been accrued over time, and Ehome have never really been able to swing the game back in their advantage at this point. VG certainly in the driver's seat at the moment, and they're putting on the pressure on the bottom lane. YJ is trying to push up the top on his Luna on his own, and VG Gaming just might be able to force him back if they want to go aggressive. They're going to move in here with the creep wave. How Super and Ice ready to go and take this fight to the high ground of Ehome's. And YJ, he's going to live with this tier 2 on his own. Fortification will come out, and should be able to finish that one as he goes back in. The Nether Blast slowly coming out, of course, from Super, just whittling away at this tier 3. And now Fenrir coming in as well. He has got that Blink Dagger. It's their last fight, so we'll see what he's able to do with the Blink. He's got Echo Slam available. All the ults are up for VG Gaming. And let's see who's going to make the first jump here. Netherworld down on the side, ready for Ehome to fight into. Now just heading up here on the Gyrocopter. Making a fair bit. DDC's just going to jump on him straight away with the telekinesis, but how, of course, does have the Aegis. But look at this, with a reverse life trade, healing him up. He's still alive. It will finally go down now. Aegis is there, ready for round 2. Can they kill him again? That's the question. No, he pulls the BKB straight away. They found the tier 3, now FY moving in as well. And he's trapped Lanham here in the kinetic field of the static storm. They're moving in, they need to kill the Naga. She has got Song available. And with the ult here from YJ, he's actually done a significant amount of damage. It's not quite enough. Can he kill Ice? Now Ice gets himself out. Looks like they'll really lose Hal here. Memory's actually stuck in the trees. He's got a blink in a second. Will he be able to make it? No, the damage is on him. Earthshaker's all stuck up. They'll find him as well here. The Yule's just slowing down the pace, so they'll get the kill nonetheless. And Ehome again with the defense. They hold the base and they force VG Gaming right back out.
They are so good at this high ground defense. I mean, I'm gonna sound like a broken record, but again, DDC finds the opening one more time, and they play it perfectly there. They find the kill on the gyro. They have to commit Laguna Blade to the first kill, but just bringing him down, forcing out the BKB immediately after, and their defensive play there, buying time. Even though Fenrir actually got a decent Echo Slime off to the side, he found 2 heroes. It's just not enough, and it's really the Glimmer Cape that's doing a lot of work for the Dire. The Glimmer Cape usage from Lanham has been exceptional this game. It's one of the reasons we've seen Zeus fall out of favor recently. Is of course,
CTY is fine. I don't know if you can He's going to try and go for a solo kill potentially here with a light strike. He's put the BKB as well with the Laguna. Oh, he gets it. Nicely done there by CTY, finding himself a solo kill on the Ice.
He tried to go for the counter kill. He did have Bloodstone ready to suicide, but thought maybe he could force CTY down there with the right clicks, and he was close. CTY is stronger in that exchange.
G-Gaming, I've got to be careful here, because E-Gaming are finding a lot of very, very big kills in response to the aggression from VG, and the fact that YJ now has this butterfly complete, 1400 gold as well. He's only about 300 gold or so behind the gyrocopter. So this Luna's going to start getting very, very, very scary. And it's going to be even harder for VG Gaming to break the base. As we've seen so far, pretty much over the last 10 minutes, they just haven't been able to do some because eHome take the fight every time.
And one of the luxuries that YJ has in this game is that he doesn't have to be very cautious with using Flutter, I feel. The gyro is going to hit him anyway because of the MKB, but the other heroes have so limited physical damage output that he could probably almost just use an aggressive Flutter with his BKB just to run in, have 522 move speed, find his designated target, and just try to bring them down as fast as possible. And it's going to put a lot of pressure on VG here.
Very nice pickup here from Lanham. He's got the completed pipe of insight, which against VG's lineup is going to be fantastic in these team fights.
Pipe and Glimmer against Zeus. How much magic resist does he have? 57% before he glimmers.
So the Thundergod's Wrath just coming out to get a bit of intel from the side of eHome, check where they're all at. But I think VG will be a little bit more careful about kind of looking for a fight and trying to get this push onto this, but they might even just hang back and wait until Hal's got another item online. He's sitting on 3,400 gold at the moment, so maybe that's when they'll look to go for the go time again. At eHome, I think they're going to be more confident in leaving the base and looking for a fight themselves. Adam's got the song available if they want to try and set it up. They've got the wall. They've got all their ultimates online. If eHome can find a jump onto VG, I can quite easily see them coming out on top of it.
Quiet in a pretty good position here to maybe force a BKB from CTY. I think if he glimpses him there, he might bait out a BKB charge from CTY, but it's down to 5 seconds anyway, so it actually doesn't really matter. If they weren't looking to fight in the next 55 seconds, it makes no difference.
FY is
all BKBs are 5, right?
I believe so, after the amount of fights we've seen.
Yeah?
Yeah. Most BKBs on the deck are all at 5 seconds. And the fact that FY, of course, he is very close. Well, he's halfway there to his Aghanim Scepter. Has the point booster, has the Ogre Club. So he's more than 50% of the way there. And that's going to be very nice against the lineup of eHome. If
actually,
he's able to track
more. He almost has it. 700
to
go.
Okay, he's got the stuff. Okay. Yep. Okay, he's very, very close indeed.
But it's still going to be a little bit complicated to set it up. Because if he doesn't catch the Naga in the Static Storm, they can always just song and disengage anyway. And with the 5-second BKBs, the timing has to be exceptional to be able to bring down key targets with both Glimmer Cape and, of course, Pipe available for Lanham.
How now? He's got a completed Satanic. So we've seen in these last few fights, one of the issues for VG is the fact that they lose Hao at the start every time. Now, if he's able to get that Satanic off, it's still going to be very hard because he seems to always get kind of chain stunned, chain locked down. He's going to have to hope that he can even get the BKB off before the fight begins or be allowed that small window to activate it in the fight. So otherwise, the Satanic isn't going to be able to do him too much. But I guess at the least, it's going to make him a lot more tankier with the extra HP.
Yeah, and he's still finding some levels for some extra stats here, but I think this is about the peak HP he will have in this game. He'll have maybe 200 more from stats and level ups, and that's it.
Oh, I like this as well. eHome, they're trying to go aggressive now. They're ready to try and look for a fight themselves onto the side of VG. Heading into the jungle here, smoked up. FY's going to back up. Pings are coming out. It looks like they're aware that something's going on. And VG just playing it careful. All grouped around towards the bottom, actually, as a four-man. Making it very hard for eHome to get a jump on them. It looks like VG will be able to avoid that rotation for the time being. How's Roshan looking? Roshan, it's still about a minute or so before we'll see when Rosh is back up. But we may at this point see both teams kind of just hang off until one of them is able to get the Aegis here. eHome just trying to take away a bit of the jungle here from VG.
This is why it's so good for VG Gaming to have taken the Rax top early, because it gives them a lot of information. When no one is pushing out this top lane, if they wait like one creep wave and no one is showing still, they know eHome are up to snuff. Like, there's no way they're just going to let this push into their base and start taking tier 4 towers, so they're definitely going for a smoke play. And for eHome to be able to pull these smoke ganks off, they need to push this top lane out very far, and I think they have to get Boots of Travel maybe on their Luna so she can push it out and join the fight afterwards. but if you're YJ right now, I don't think you want to go for them. I think you want to get another fighting item first, maybe a Satanic for him as well. Looks like that is the build. He has it now if he wants to buy it, or what's he...
Yeah, he's 20 short.
He's going to get it in a sec.
So maybe with the Satanic Butterfly on the Luna, I mean, it's the fact that the Jara has got that MKB with the Satanic. It's going to be quite a close fight, I feel, between these two. They're at pretty similar power levels at the moment. We'll see who's able to get the jump. Hanging around Roche here. It looks like it's going to be a longer respawn here, so both teams got about 3 minutes or so until Roche is available again.
There it is. Satanic and the Axe
Disruptor. Okay.
And there's a couple of items to keep in mind here. Of course, the number one item we always talk about when we have Aghanim Scepter Disruptor in play is the BKB. Yeah. But there are a lot of other items that are very valuable for EHOME. They can't use the Yules of Lina or the Shiva's Guard. The Luna cannot use her Satanic, which could prove to be absolutely huge. And should they manage to catch out Lanham, there's no Pipe, there's no Crest, there's no Glimmer Cape. It's a really big item right now, but the difficult thing for FY is going to be to find the right position. Of course, he does have Blink Dagger, but... Well, maybe it's not so hard after all. They can Zeus ult, and he can blink and find his target of choice and basically almost force a one-for-one trade.
Oh, they're going to jump in and straight onto YJ, but they don't catch him in the kinetic. They've got the Glimmer Stone, but no, the KB's there. He's going to be fine. And now, the side of EHOME trying to reinitiate, moving in, they take away the Nether Ward. Now, YJ with the ultimate, trying to find how, and he'll catch the TP. House over the high ground, will put the BKB, but the Laguna Blade go for it. How getting low? He's trying to fight for this, but he goes down here. Nice echo sound from Fenrir, though. He catches two. They'll fight both of those kills, but Fenrir loses his life. Super trying to for the live trade here on CTY, and it is a 2-for-2 at the moment here. Is anything more going to kick off? TP's and then cancels it straight away. Gets himself glimpsed actually away. Won't get trapped up by the kinetic field as well. RTK is going to be all right. Super ice, and FY the only ones to remain alive here for Vici. Let's see if they can find anything more. Actually, going into the wall here, and RTK is going to chase it down here with a vacuum. But now the live trade, RTK's going to be careful. Oh! Only just able to get himself away. ice just straight up kills himself. Realizes that he hasn't got a chance in hell against CTY.
Wait, so how did Gyro get up there?
Did you not get vacuumed up?
No, because the vacuum was somewhere else, I think. I feel like he used the vacuum further down.
He might have got four-staffed. There's a fair
did he get four-staffed by his own teammate? Because there's no aggressive four-staff, right?
Either way, it did not go down well for Hal that one.
How did that happen?
How?
Did they force-staff him with their own Pugna? Like, I'm sure I saw another vacuum than that one. And he can't have been up there for like 30 seconds straight.
Nonetheless, 21-18 again, EHOME finding some very good fights.
Oh, he got lifted by Rubick.
There we go. Sin. I know, there's a reason why we have you here on the casting desk.
Yeah, so that I can get answers from Twitch chat.
Thanks, Twitch chat.
You know, yeah.
49 minutes in coming in now.
I'm actually drawing all my knowledge from
Let's have a look at the graphs. And how are
I'm
we
just
doing?
Telegraphing their comments to you.
6,000 still for VG. They're kind of holding on here, VG. Experience difference still snap bang around zero. But you got to be honest, the fact that EHOME are holding on as well as they are, with the fact that they are down a set of racks, is... It's looking up for the side of the die. Lina now with 3.5k gold on top of the Aghanims, and YJ continuing to just look very, very scary. Yeah, I've got the Gyrocopter now. 2,000 ahead, coming up to 3k gold. We'll see what he goes for his next item. And they're just playing it safe here, VG farming up. Roshan is going to spawn now. So we'll see which team's able to take that. It looks like both are a little bit interested. Moving in towards the nearby. And here we go. Okay. Now. Is he going to head in for this one? I think he's ready to fight around at EHOME there on the high ground. They're ready to return engagement if anything kicks off. Rubick trying to build towards his Aghanim's top lane as well. YJ just pushing it in. He's feeling very confident. He knows that they're all around the Roche pit. He's got this space to go for it.
This is the kind of situation EHOME want to end up in, where this top lane has so much momentum that YJ could be anywhere right now. If he... Once again, we might consider Boots of Travel as the next item for the Luna here. Let's see if that is going to be the choice or if he wants to. Because if he completes his inventory first, these split push plays are not an option anymore, and that's a really big problem. So I think he kind of has to go for Boots of Travel before he gets his sixth item. Let's see what the choice is, though.
Okay, moving in here, just putting the Glimmer down on Zara TK.
Trying to, I don't know. That can't really have baited out of EKB. There's no way he's going to fall for that one.
Lanham's there as well. Lanham, of course, with the song available, but Vici still not quite ready to move in. Now they're going to head down towards the river, but they're just both teams being very, very scared of each other here. No one really wanting to make the first jump, no one wanting to commit. They're waiting for each other to go.
This is a big item, and it's the best item C2Y could get right now, I think.
I mean, he can burst down pretty much any hero on the side of VG now, can't he?
So Gyro has 2,500 health, yeah. And Lina can, with two Laguna Blades, deal 1,900. So if they just tickle him a little bit first, C2Y can blow him up in one go.
And they want to do something big here with the pressure reveal.
Satanic can easily turn it around if Hao gets the first Laguna Blade. In a state, if he gets to Satanic and just hit two or three times,
well, this could be big
two wasted Lagunas. Yeah, here we go.
If they can find a jump here, they do have the Thunder Ghost Refugee. If they pop it, this would be a great time to do so, but they're not going to go through. And here we go, they're going to pop it now. And oh, they actually get down the Static Storm here. This might disrupt the Eho's fight. But why'd you get on the BKB? Looking for Hao. Trying to take down Hao. Hao gets to the BKB. He's going to be okay for the time being. They've already lost the Rubik here on the side of Eho. Now Lanham comes out with the song, trying to set something up. They want to get rid of this Nether Ward. RTK moving him with the punches. YJ's going to help him out as well. They're getting rid of the Nether Ward. The Wolf being dropped. But Fenrir now with the Echo Sam on the YJ. Another refresh from Ice. The second ult comes out. Two of them dead. Lanham's got the TP himself out, but he's going to get clips. Arnold's moving it on to RTK and find the Darkseid. They'll also get the Naga Siren. Triple kill for Ice. That refresher ult setting it up perfectly. And Eho enforced back to their base. Very nicely done there by VG. And they'll probably get the Roshan off the back of this as well. And I mean, no buybacks available at all on Eho.
Yeah, the only piece of good news for Eho there is that CTY manages to kill off the Disruptor in the end with a second Laguna Blade, but he didn't get both of them off. I think it was a Glimmer Cape play onto the Gyro that saved Hao there. It looked like CTY could be able to blow him up, but don't manage to execute it well enough, and this is going to be a Roshan. It's going to be most likely some aggressive warding if they have any on any of their heroes, which actually looks like they don't. Nobody has any wards on the Radiant right now.
It's going to be the cheese here as well for the side of VG. There's a Hex now onto your Pugna.
Yeah. Good item pickup, of course. Especially now that BKBs run low on duration. It's a lot easier to get a Hex off that is high impact.
VG, let's see if they're ready to try and go for the base push again. We saw them do it about 20 minutes ago, and after that ended badly. They haven't really been back here, but now with the Aegis and Cheese, maybe VG, Hao and the gang are ready to go for it. And here we go, DDC though again with the initiation. Can they just stun it? No, Hao's going to be okay here for the timing. Gonna get tough. Now with the net from down, can they stay stun it up? Hao is bringing him low here. Fortification will come out for the side of Eho. Ice blinking forward though. Spamming out the Arc Lightning and the Lightning Bolt, just keeping Eho back, and they'll find the Tier 3 now. So there's no Tier 3s remaining for the side of Eho. Just their last two sets of exposed racks. And VG may be ready to move in for more. Fenrir, the one holding the cheese here, has got the Echo Slam. I haven't got the Echo Slam, but it's a man. FY setting this up onto YJ. He's been hexed up as well, but Lanham with the song. He's trying to stop this and may even want to turn this around, but the Thunder God's Wrath coming out. Eho on the retreat. They just can't fight into this one. They'll get rid of the missile, but the VG will just move in, start to hit away the racks. DDC again with the telekinesis, but the vacuum wall! Catching three BKBs being popped by Howard. Super luck training to Darkseid. RMTK won't go down. Will be able to get himself out. Pipes being popped by Eho. They just can't really dent the armor of VG Gaming, even with a lovely vacuum wall. Now look at the stun on Tahan. What will he be able to steal here? DJ, okay, he's got the humming missile. Ice moving forward. YJ incredibly low, but it puts the BKB now on the set down, trying to fight onto Ice. Turn towards Howard. The stolen missile actually holding Hao down there. Super with the life drain for the low ground. Can they kill him for the second time? But there's the first Laguna Blade. Hao, he's going to be bombed. Fenrir with the Echo Snap. He has the Fitcher onto two. TTY is getting low calibre now. Yes, the final leader. They might just lose FY. No, the Glimmer Cave. He's going to be all right here. Hao gets himself a double kill. Fenrir moving it onto YJ. With the life drain, it's GG. Finally, VG break the gauge and they break down Eho. They win game one.
That was so extremely close to being another hold from Eho.
What a game of just calculations, just both teams playing it careful. We saw VG go for the base push. Two times it was unsuccessful. They held themselves back. Eho came out, they looked for an engagement. It wasn't a good one. And then VG, after the roast, they felt that they could go for another try at the base, and this time it was successful.
This is very, very high.